So I don't know about you, but I am so thankful to be able to see 2021. Thankful, not necessarily because of the year, but because God has graced me enough and graced you enough to allow us to be able to enter into this new year, that God brought us through 2020 with all of the challenges, all of the ups and downs, that God remained faithful. So on this first Sunday of the year, I want to bless God. I want to worship him. I want to encourage you. Let's worship him together. Let's honor him. Let's celebrate him. Let's give him everything that he deserves. So we want to take just a moment just to offer a word of prayer, to talk to our daddy for a moment, just to give a word of thanks. So let's bow together. Daddy, thank you so much for who you are. Thank you for all of the many blessings you have bestowed upon us. Thank you, God, that you brought us through 2020, that you remained faithful, God, in the midst of everything that went on in our lives. God, thank you, God, that you kept us. Thank you that you sustained us, God. Thank you, God, that you loved on us. So, Father, as we begin this new year, we want to begin the new year with our eyes on you. So we surrender ourselves and declare we are nothing without you. So we bow before you and we ascribe worth to you. We declare that you are holy and you are righteous, that all the glory and all the honor rightfully belongs to you. So God, as we worship you today, we pray that you would inhabit the praise of your people. We know we're scattered in a bunch of homes, God. Some people are on their jobs. Some are in their cars. Some may even be traveling. But we believe that you can meet us right where we are as we surrender ourselves to you. God, have your way now. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's worship our God.
So we lift up all.
the name. Blessed be the name. Blessed be the name. 'Cause you So we're so blessed on this first Sunday of the year to be able to commune together. For those of you who may not be followers of Christ and you've tuned in, as followers of Christ, we have a time where Jesus tells us to remember him. The communion really is connected to what the Jews called the Passover, when they would celebrate the Lord allowing the death angel to pass over so they could get out of Egypt. And Jesus the Christ, when he came and served as a sacrifice, it's because of his shed blood that our sins are forgiven and that we have the opportunity to be in relationship with God the Father. So Jesus told us that we can take some bread and the bread will represent his body, and we will drink of the cup. The juice reminds us of his blood. So if you haven't gotten your bread yet and your juice, if you don't have bread and juice, then you can get what you have in the house and bring it, as we have a time where we commune together, where we connect with one another. You see me standing before a table. Jesus, when he broke the bread and passed the cup, it was at the Last Supper that he had with the disciples. They were able to have a meal together. And that's what we're doing as the family of God. When we trust in Jesus Christ, we're invited to the table so that everybody who's a part of the family can come to the table of God. And as a family, we can eat of the same bread and drink of the same cup, being reminded that it's because of Jesus that we're able to be in the family. So I want to encourage you as you reflect this morning upon Jesus the Christ, maybe as you go get your bread and get your juice, we want to just sing a song to prepare our hearts and our minds for this sacred moment and this sacred time. And then after singing a portion of the song, we'll come back and read a portion of scripture, and then we'll eat of the bread and drink of the cup together. So go ahead and get your communion. If you have it already, let's sit, let's meditate, let's reflect upon the goodness of our God. Simple song reminds us. Said at last and did my Savior bleed, and did my sovereign die. Would he behold that sacred head for such a worm as I? The chorus says, at the cross where I first saw the light and the burdens of my heart rolled away. It was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day. So Paul writes to us in 1 Corinthians chapter 10, the cup of blessing that we bless, is it not a sharing in the blood of Christ? The bread that we break, is it not a sharing in the body of Christ? Verse 17, he says, because there is one bread, we who are many are one body, since all of us share the same bread. Paul reminds the believers in Corinth and reminds us that all of us enter into the family of God by faith in Jesus Christ. So today we celebrate him. We celebrate him as we take of the bread. And we remember that the Son of God came in the flesh and we called him Jesus. And he says, this bread represents my body. He says, eat of it and share in my life. So this morning, as we eat of the bread together, we share in the life of Jesus Christ. So let's eat of the bread. He likewise took the cup and passed it to his disciples. And he said, drink of the cup. This cup represents my blood, which will be shed for you. It's because of the shed blood of Jesus the Christ, the perfect Lamb, the one who is without sin, that all of our sin is forgiven. So we come to God because of what Christ has done, not because we deserve it, not because we're good enough, but we come because we know that our sin has been covered in the blood of Jesus. And because of his shed blood, we are forgiven. So as we drink of the cup today, we thank Jesus for his shed blood. We thank him for the forgiveness of sin. And we thank him that because of him, we are made whole. So let's drink of the cup together. So the songwriter celebrated that it's because of the cross, and it's at the cross that everything for us changed. So today, that's what we celebrate as a community of believers. Though we're scattered in our different households, we celebrate the fact that we are united in Christ, that we eat of one bread, who is Jesus the Christ. We're covered in that one blood of Jesus the Christ. And because of him, we are part of one family, the family of God. So this morning, we celebrate the cross. Sing it with me. At the cross, at the cross where I first saw the light and the burdens of my heart rolled away. It was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day. So Father, we thank you for Jesus the Christ. We thank you for his shed blood. We thank you that by faith we're able to trust in him, be saved, be delivered, be rescued, and become a part of your family. So we place our hope in him, our confidence in him. It is Jesus. It's always Jesus. And as we cling to him, we say thank you for allowing us to be a part of your family. Thank you for allowing us to be able to eat of the bread and drink of the cup as one family on this day. So we celebrate you. Hear our prayer now. In Jesus' name, amen. I hope that that song stays in your heart. As we prepare in just a few moments for the word of God, I pray that that song stirs you like never before. Where I first saw the light and the burdens of my heart rolled away. It was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day. Bless God for the cross.
It is indeed a blessing to be able to commune together for the first time this year. We encourage you to get your family and friends as you gather around the kitchen table, the television, the laptop, or even your cell phone as we move further in this service. Your announcements for this year are as follows. If you've given your life to Christ and you're ready to be baptized, we would like for you to join us for baptism orientation on January 6th. Please be sure to use the information on the screen to contact the baptism committee so that you can get all the information about baptism orientation. If you haven't taken any classes yet and you're interested in taking a class, joining Sunday school, Awana, or any of the other activities that we have starting in a couple of weeks in January, get ready because we have a lot of classes coming up. If you've joined us for classes before, you know that we'll be doing classes again via MS Teams or Zoom. Whether you've participated in a class before or it's your first time, we encourage everyone to join us. Student ministry activities, as well as our other classes, will resume the week of January 11th. So please check out the website and get ready to join us. Now get your family and friends, tell them it's time for the Word of God. Whether you're watching on your cell phone or on your television or your laptop, get ready to be blessed by the word.
Well, I pray that this morning has been a blessing to you, the opportunity for us to worship together on the first Sunday of the year, and then for us to be able to commune together, to eat of the bread and drink of the cup, to celebrate the death, burial, and resurrection of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. To be reminded that we are one family, one body, one community, even though we can't physically gather, that doesn't take away from the fact that we are still united in Christ and Christ sees us as one. Well, as we begin this new year, I know some of you are real excited because we finally entered into 2021. You were not as much probably as excited about 2021 coming in as you were about 2020 ending, because the reality is for many of us, 2020 was tough. 2020 was exhausting. 2020 was wearying for many of us. 2020 took the life out of us. It knocked the air out of us. And as we enter into 2021, we're trying to regroup. We're trying to get our heads together, trying to refocus, trying to maybe get renewed and refreshed. And for others, you're like, man, I'm ready to go. I'm ready to go. I'm ready to go. But you're still dealing with some of the drag of 2020. Well, no matter what space you may be in on today, I just thought we'd take this first sermon just to encourage us to hang in there, to encourage us to keep in the race, to stay in the race, to encourage us to finish the race, to encourage us not to throw in the towel, to encourage us not to quit, to encourage us to stick with Jesus. And that's really what I want to do today. Just want to encourage us to stick with Jesus, because truth be told, some of us, our faith took a hit. We prayed some prayers that we were hoping God would answer, and we didn't see the answers that we wanted to see. Some of us, we lost big time. We lost family members. We lost friends, we lost jobs, we lost some other things, maybe physically or other things as a result of losing jobs. For some of us, we just lost in 2020, and we're trying to readjust. And as we try to readjust, we thinking about, man, what do I really feel about Jesus? Where am I with my faith? It was much easier when I could get to the building and be with the saints and be able to sing songs with the saints and worship with the saints. It was much easier when I can get to a place and somebody else could hug me and love on me and know to pray with me and pray for me. And with everything that's been going on with the pandemic, for some of us, we feel so isolated and so alone. So the weight of everything that has been occurring seems like it's been heavier than any time before in our lives. And I just want to encourage us to stick with Jesus. This morning, as we look at our passage, it's going to come from Hebrews chapter 12. I want to read two verses from Hebrews chapter 12. But before I read the verses, I just want to highlight that the writer of Hebrews is writing to a group of Christians who are tired. He's writing to a group of Christians who are weary. He's writing to a group of Christians who embraced the faith. They were Jews who accepted Jesus the Christ as the Messiah. They trusted in him. They've been trying to live according to the gospel. They've been attacked by Jews who did not accept Jesus. They're questioning now their belief system, and they're struggling with whether or not they should go back to Judaism or stick with Jesus. There are some who are weary because of persecution that is taking place because of their faith in Jesus the Christ. They're receiving persecution from Jews and persecution from non-Jews. They're being rejected. They're struggling. They're trying to hold on. And some have walked away. Some have given up. Some have thrown in the towel to say, I'm done. I can't take it anymore. This is too much. And the writer of Hebrews writes to them to encourage them to stick with Jesus, to encourage them not to quit, to encourage them not to throw in the towel, to encourage them to stay in the race. And he begins his encouragement actually in Hebrews chapter 1. Listen to his opening line, centering everything on Jesus. Hebrews chapter 1, beginning at verse 1. He says, long ago, God spoke to our ancestors by the prophets at different times and in different ways. In these last days, he has spoken to us by his Son. God has appointed him heir of all things and made the universe through him. The Son is the radiance of God's glory and the exact expression of his nature, sustaining all things by his powerful word. After making purification of sins, he sat down at the right hand of the majesty on high. So he became superior to the angels, just as the name he inherited is more excellent than theirs. The author started off trying to center them on Jesus the Christ, to say that God has spoken in various times in various ways before, but he ultimately spoke to his people through his Son, Jesus the Christ, and that Jesus the Christ is superior to everything that they've been exposed to everything that they've encountered in their history. Jesus the Christ is superior. So in chapters 1 and 2, he writes that Jesus is superior or greater than the angels that serve God. He writes in chapters 3 3 and 4 that Jesus is superior or greater than Moses, their great leader that led them out of Egypt and led them through the wilderness, but they rebelled against Moses, and as a result, they were in the wilderness for a period of time. But Jesus is greater, as Moses couldn't lead them into that time of rest. Jesus will lead his people into a time of rest. In chapters 5 and 7, he writes to let them know that Jesus is greater than the priest. The priests serve within the Levitical system, doing their part, making sacrifices on behalf of the people, but having to make sacrifices for themselves because they were imperfect. But Jesus is greater than every priest and greater than every high priest because he is perfect and he is sinless and he is eternal. And then in chapters 8 through 10, writes that Jesus is greater than the old covenant, the new covenant that Jesus establishes, the old covenant based on the sacrificial system, but the new covenant that is based on the finished work of Jesus Christ is greater because Jesus gave an offering once and for all, and it settled everything. Sin debt paid in full. No more offerings need to be made. And then in chapter 11, he brings up some names of people who were a part of their history to remind them that these people were not perfect. They were not sinless. They were not flawless. They were disobedient at times. They struggled at times, but they kept the faith. He writes to them to encourage them to stick with Jesus, to encourage them not to quit, to encourage them to stay in the race, to encourage them to stay strong, to encourage them to cling to the Christ that they know and the Christ that they love. And then for our text in chapter 12, verse 1, he says, "Therefore, since we also have such a large cloud of witnesses surrounding us, let us lay aside every hindrance and the sin that so easily ensnares us. Let us run with endurance the race that lies before us, keeping our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer, author, and perfecter of our faith. For the joy that lay before him, he endured the cross, despising the shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God." You see, he writes to this audience, and as he talks to them about Jesus being greater and then providing the examples of historical figures that they've heard about all of their lives and pointing to the faith that they have, he says, "Therefore, since we have this crowd of witnesses," what he does here is he brings up this imagery of athletic competition that they would be familiar with, this imagery of athletic competition in a coliseum where people are seated in the audience looking upon the competition. People seated, and as they're seated, they're looking upon, they're watching. He brings in that imagery and says, "Therefore, since we have this great cloud of witnesses," these people, possibly those he referenced in chapter 11, who have gone before us, who can witness to the fact and testify to the fact that God is faithful, that God is a keeper, that God is a provider, that God is a way maker, that God can give you strength in the midst of your weakness, that God does keep his promises. As we look at this great crowd of witnesses, he says, "Therefore, since they are surrounding us, let us do something." If we're going to make sure that we focus and stick with Jesus in the midst of the weariness, maybe from 2020, and as we deal with some of the frustrations and challenges, I think there are a few things in this passage that we can take and learn, two things that we can do in the beginning of 2021 that's going to help us as we make it through this journey, that's going to help us to cling to Jesus, that's going to help us to persevere, that's going to help us to stick it out. And those two things are simply this. I'm going to encourage us to encourage ourselves and to focus on Jesus. To encourage ourselves and focus on Jesus. I want to encourage somebody right now to type in the comment section, "encourage yourself," and right after that type, "focus on Jesus." Those are the two things that I believe if we can do in 2021, it's going to help us to stick it out. It's going to help us to persevere. It's going to help us to stick with Jesus. Listen to what he says as he writes to them. He talks to them about, "Let us endure the race that is set before us. We're going to get to him saying lay aside those weights and those sins. But look at the focus. We need to endure the race that is set before us. In 2021, I want to encourage each of us. Don't wait on somebody else to come along to encourage you. I want to challenge you to learn how to encourage yourself. How do you encourage yourself? Oftentimes, encouragement of self involves self-talk. So if we're going to encourage ourselves, let's do some self-talk based on the passage. He says we got to endure this race. We got to persevere through this race. The idea of endure or persevere suggests to us that this is a long race. If I got to endure it or I got to persevere it, that suggests that it's not anything quick. So if we're going to encourage ourselves, then I want to encourage us to tell ourselves that this is a marathon and not a sprint. As we begin 2021, we got to remind ourselves our journey is not a sprint, but it's a marathon. A marathon is 26.2 miles, and anyone who has ever run a marathon will tell you it's exhausting. For the average person, it takes about 4 to 5 hours to run a marathon. Life is a marathon. And sometimes in the midst of life, when we get down and we get frustrated and we get discouraged, we need to remind ourselves it's a marathon, not a sprint. See, when I think it's a sprint, I'm expecting it to be over. I'm expecting it to be over quick so I can kick my feet up, so I can relax, so I can chill out and rest a while. But if I understand it's a marathon, then I'm reminding myself I gotta suck it up. I gotta pull it together. I gotta press through. A part of encouraging ourselves is reminding ourselves that life is a marathon. And I believe that's what the Hebrew writer is trying to challenge these Christians to understand, those who have gotten tired and weary and ready to throw in the towel. He wants to challenge them to remember that it's a marathon, so they got to persevere. Not only is it a marathon, but if we're going to encourage ourselves because we know it's a marathon, then we need to tell ourselves that quitting is not an option. You see, life is a marathon, and because it's a marathon, I need to remind myself that I can't quit. He says, let us run with endurance the race that lies before us. We got to remind ourselves when our limbs get tired. Oftentimes, people who have run a marathon talk about this notion of hitting the wall. They typically talk about hitting the wall. They say that people typically around the 20th mile hit a wall. They get to a place where their limbs suddenly get heavy. Their energy seems to be totally drained, and self-doubt starts to creep in. They're wondering if they can finish and why should they finish and should they just celebrate the fact that they've made it this far and why not just quit now? They talk about hitting the wall where it seems like everything has just left you. But those who complete the marathon have talked about the importance of learning how to press through the wall, and pressing through the wall by learning to pace themselves, pressing through the wall by learning to hydrate, pressing through the wall by learning to eat the appropriate things during the race. They do all of that because in their minds, they're like, man, I've worked too hard. I've come too far to quit in the middle of the race. I gotta persevere. I gotta keep going because quitting is not an option. And if you're going to encourage yourself, I want to just encourage you to tell yourself in those low days, quitting is not an option. I don't believe that God has brought me this far for God to give up on me now. And if God is not going to give up on me, then I surely cannot give up on myself. Remind yourself that quitting is not an option. So we're going to tell ourselves it's a marathon, not a sprint. We're going to remind ourselves that quitting is not an option. And we're going to encourage ourselves by reminding ourselves that anything that doesn't help me is a hindrance. See, sometimes we need to tell ourselves that anything that's not helping us to achieve the goal, to be just like Jesus, to act like Jesus, to love like Jesus, to live like Jesus, it's a hindrance. Notice he says to them, let us lay aside the weight and the sins which do so easily beset us. Hear what he's saying. He says, lay aside the weights. See, when they competed during their time in athletic events, they would almost compete naked. They would want to take off everything they could so that they wouldn't have anything to get in the way of their competition. They didn't want any garment causing them to trip or slowing them down. So they would strip away everything that could hinder them from achieving their goal. And that's the idea of laying aside the weights. There are things that are not sin, but they can slow us down or hinder us or get in the way. And as we think about the things in our lives, there are things that are good that just get in the way of us being who God has called us to be, or get in the way of us doing what God has called us to do, or get in the way of us being able to spend time in our word or spend time in prayer, or get in the way of us being able to serve people or love people. He suggests that anything that's going to slow us down, anything potentially that could get in the way, we need to lay it aside. And I want to encourage us to go through a process of evaluating in 2021 the things that we're doing, the things that we're involved in, the things that we're committed to, and asking ourselves, how is this helping me to be more like Jesus? How is this helping me to love more like Jesus? How is this helping me to live more like Jesus? How is this helping me to serve more like Jesus? This thing that I'm engaged in, that I'm participating in, does it cause my conscience to feel clean? Or after I engage in it or participate in it, is my conscience weighted down with burdens? As we evaluate what we're doing, how we're spending our time, how we're spending our energy, we just want to raise the question, is it a weight, something that's dragging me down? Because if it's not pushing me towards being more like Christ, then it's probably pulling me from being more like Christ. So he says, let's lay aside the weight and the sin. See, he suggests that there are some things that are weights. They're not sin, but there are some things that are sin. Sin, unlike a weight hinders me, a weight slows me down, but sin entangles me. It's like being caught in a trap, and because we're caught in a trap, we can't move, we can't go further. We've been ensnared by the sin. We thought we could handle it. We thought we could manage it, but before we knew it, sin got the best of us. It took us further than we wanted to go. It made us pay more than we initially thought we would have to pay. He says, let's lay aside the weight and the sin that easily besets us. See, it's this reminder that anything that is not helping me in being all that God wants me to be is hindering me. And we have to do self-talk by encouraging ourselves to evaluate, is this helping me or hindering me? As we begin 2021, I want to encourage us to encourage ourselves that it's a marathon, it's not a sprint. To encourage ourselves by reminding us that in the midst of everything that's going on, that quitting is not an option. To encourage ourselves by reminding ourselves that anything that doesn't help us is hindering us. But not only do I believe that he encourages them to encourage themselves through the text, but then he encourages them to focus on Jesus. See, as we begin 2021, we're going to encourage ourselves, but we also want to make sure that we have our focus in the right place. Notice what he says, keeping our eyes on Jesus, the source and perfecter of our faith. For the joy that lay before him, he endured the cross, despising the shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. His challenge to those who are runners, those of us who are living the life that God has called us to live, those of us who are on this journey trying to honor God with every breath and every minute and every hour and every day of our lives, those of us who are on this journey trying to remain committed to Christ and to faithfully serve Christ, to persevere, to complete the race that God has set before us, he suggests that the way to do that is to make sure that our focus is on Jesus. It stood out to me that he encourages them to focus on Jesus. He started with man seeing that we have this great crowd of witnesses, but the crowd is not to be the object of our focus. I think sometimes as we read the Bible, we get our focus out of place. We start to celebrate the Bible characters of Abraham and Isaac and Jacob, and we start to celebrate the Davids of the Bible, and we start to celebrate the various kings of the Bible. And as we start to celebrate the characters and lock into them and what they do and what they did, it takes our focus off Jesus. But notice he says the crowd is not the object of our focus. Thank God for their testimonies. Thank God for their faithfulness, but they're not the object of our focus. Notice also that if we're going to fix our eyes on Jesus, it's important for us to be reminded that other runners are not the object of our focus. Other people who are on this journey with us, who are trying to serve God, who are trying to live for God, who are trying to honor God with their lives, we're not to put our eyes on them and get caught up in comparison what they're doing and how they're doing it. No, other runners are not our focus. Also realize that circumstances are not our focus. Runners realize that there are a few things they can control. They can control their preparation. They can control their diet. They can control their hydration, but they can't control the weather. They can't control on the day that they run whether it's hot or cold. They can't control whether the sun is high in the sky or it's raining. They can't control what the road conditions are going to be like. So circumstances are not to be our focus. He says, fix our eyes on Jesus. And I want to encourage us as we begin 2021 to fix our eyes on Jesus, to focus on Jesus. For he says in the passage that we focus on Jesus as our example. He is the one who has gone before us. Just lifting up the name Jesus points to the person and the work of Jesus the Christ, the Son of God, who came in the flesh, that we might be able to see him interact with people. As we read the Gospels, we hear about his interactions with those who liked him and those who disliked him, his interactions with those who were considered outsiders or sinners. We get to see his life and see his example, to see how he dealt with those who spit on them and those who rejected him. We get to fix our eyes on Jesus, to focus on his example. And as we focus on his example, the goal is that we follow his example. It's that we put our feet in the footsteps of Jesus, that we look at how he handled things and how he dealt with things and how he talked about things, and we're to do exactly the same thing. He says, focus on Jesus, which means to look at Jesus as our example. But focusing on Jesus is not just to focus on him as our example, it's also to focus on him as our assurance. He says Jesus is the author and finisher of our faith, or the source and perfecter of our faith. Jesus, as the author, is the initiator or chief leader of our faith. He is the one who made it possible for us to be in this race, to be a part of the family of God, to be able to have access to the Father. He is the one who led the way, who set the pace, who established the course. He is the one who modeled a life of obedience to the Father and a life of surrender to the Father. He is the author of our faith, but he's also the finisher of our faith. He is the one who continued his journey, who fulfilled everything that the Father asked him to do, who laid down his life on Calvary's cross and took it up again on the third day. He defeated death and the grave, and Satan rose victoriously and triumphantly on the third day. So he is our assurance that we do have a relationship with the Father, our assurance that if the Father would go to this extent to send his Son to lay down his life for us and take it up again, that the Father does love us, our assurance that the Father is committed to us, our assurance that the Father is working on our behalf. Jesus is our assurance. And he says, looking to Jesus, because when we look to Jesus, we are reminded that God is for us and not against us, that everything we need in this life, God has supplied as a result of the finished work of Jesus. He says, keep our eyes on Jesus, because he is our assurance. But not only do we keep our eyes on Jesus because he is our assurance, we keep our eyes on Jesus because he is our victory. And the scripture says that Jesus, who for the joy that was set before him, endured the cross, despising the shame, and then he sat down at the right hand of the Father. He sat down to suggest, I'm done. He endured that which they considered to be an ugly thing, the death on a cross, the dying on a tree. He endured the rejection from his people. He despised the shame. He endured the cross. But in the end, he sat down at the right hand of the Father. The right hand is metaphorically a position of power. He sat down in that place of power. And we hear this again and again throughout this letter. Again, Hebrews 1, in the introduction, he talks about after making purification for his sins, he sat down at the right hand of the majesty on high. In Hebrews 8 and 1, it says, now the main point of what is being said is this: we have this kind of high priest who sat down at the right hand of the throne of majesty in heaven. And then in Hebrews 10, 11 and 12, he says, every priest stands day after day ministering and offering the same sacrifice time after time, which can never take away sin. But this man, after offering one sacrifice for sins forever, sat down at the right hand of God. You see, him sitting down at the right hand of God suggests it's done, it's finished, it's over. It suggests that I'm in your favor, that I'm in this place of authority. So whatever you need while you're running your race, I got you. If you need strength, I got you. If you need peace, I made provision for you. If you need joy, I got you. Whatever you need, Jesus says, I got you. He says, keep our eyes fixed and focused on Jesus. And that's my encouragement today, that as we begin 2021, I know some of us have been tired. Some of us, a lot has been taken out of us. But I want to challenge us to stick with Jesus, to stick with Jesus by encouraging ourselves, to stick with Jesus by maintaining our focus on Jesus, and to resolve in our head and our heart that no matter what 2021 brings, we're going to finish the race before us. No matter what comes our way, we don't know what's coming in this year, just as we had no idea what was coming in 2020, but a resolve in our head and our heart that no matter what comes, I'm going to trust Jesus. I'm going to keep my eyes on Jesus, and I'm going to encourage myself to make sure that no matter how hard it gets, I'm going to finish the race. You see, it was in Mexico City in 1968, during an Olympic marathon, that John Stephen Akwari of Tanzania ran the marathon. He ran with a whole bunch of other runners in that particular marathon, and as he ran, he had a tough run. He endured a lot of different challenges. He had problems with his leg, and because of having problems with his leg, that slowed him down, and others are running at their pace. He couldn't run at his pace that he had trained for, that he had conditioned for. His leg finally got so bad that his leg started bleeding, and his running was very slow, and he was limping, and he hit that wall, so he was experiencing the pain and the heartache and the cramps and the dehydration. He was disoriented, but he had a resolve that he had to finish the race. An hour after all of the other competitors completed the race, John Stephen came across the finish line. He came across the finish line dehydrated again. He was disoriented, but he made it across the finish line. And when he made it across the finish line, because it's an hour later and he's obviously beat up and beat down, his leg is bleeding, it's been bandaged, but he finished the race. A reporter wanted to ask him, why did you work so hard to finish the race? And in that moment, he said, My country didn't send me this far to start the race. They sent me to finish it. And I want to encourage us to know that Jesus has done all that he has done for us to finish the race that is before us. He didn't do everything just for us to start the race. He didn't declare victory over death and victory over the grave and victory over Satan just for us to start it and throw in the towel in the middle. No, he did everything that he's done, and he's at the right hand of the Father now working on our behalf so that we can finish the race, so that we can be reminded that he who started the work in us is going to complete the work. My encouragement to you on this first Sunday of 2021 is stick with Jesus and resolve in your head and your heart, no matter what the year brings, I'm going to finish the race, because Jesus did too much for me just to start. He's doing everything that he's doing so that I can finish. Let's pray together. Father, thank you today for your word from Hebrews 12. Thank you that in your word, we're reminded that we can encourage ourselves. It's a marathon. It's not going to be quick. It's not going to be easy. But God, as we run the race that is before us, we can trust God and believe that Jesus will bring us through. Jesus, thank you for being our example. Thank you for being the one who went before us, who set the path for us to follow. Thank you for being the author and the finisher of our faith. Thank you for being seated at the right hand of the Father to make provision for everything that we need in this journey. Encourage our hearts today. Encourage our minds today so that we can stick with you and know that with you, we can not just start, but we can finish well. So bless us to finish well in this year. For your glory and your honor, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. So as we close out this first service of the new year, the one person we can hold on to, no matter what this year may bring, is Jesus the Christ. So I want to encourage you to decide within your mind and in your heart that you're going to keep the name of Jesus on your lips. When you have your good days, allow the name of Jesus to be on your lips. When you have your bad days, allow the name of Jesus to be on your lips. So we pray today as we close out that God would bless you, that he would keep you. We pray that he would strengthen you, that he would encourage you. We pray that the name of Jesus would be a reminder to you that you are covered, that you are kept, that you are sustained. And as you keep his name on your lips, that you would be reminded that you have victory in his name. You're more than a conqueror in his name. So we bless God for the name of Jesus. So God, we thank you and we trust you. Hear our prayer as we worship you on the way out. So we know we pray, but we want you to sing with us just this simple song to close out this service today. Just simply says, Jesus. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Jesus, 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 Jesus. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Jesus is his name. Come on, can you say that where you are? Declare. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Sweet name. Jesus, 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 Jesus. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Jesus is his name. Do you know he's a savior? Savior, savior, savior. Savior, savior, savior. Savior, savior, savior. Jesus is his name. Come on, if you're glad to be saved, why don't you proclaim him? Savior, savior, savior. Savior, savior, savior. Savior, savior, savior. Jesus. Jesus is his name. Somebody know him to be a healer, so proclaim it. Healer, healer, healer. Yes, he is. Healer, healer, healer. Healer, healer, healer. Jesus is his name. Come on, declare he's a healer again. Healer, healer, healer. Healer, healer, healer. Healer, healer, healer. Jesus is his name. Come on, let's just say Jesus, Jesus. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Come on, even your children can say it. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Jesus is his name. Come on, one last time. Jesus, Jesus. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Proclaim it where you are. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Jesus is his name. Say that name. Jesus is his name. Sweetest name, Jesus is his name. Jesus is his name. So as you go throughout the rest of this year, go throughout the rest of the day, just keep his name on your lips and proclaim Jesus is his name. Thank you so much for joining us in our first service of the new year, 2021. We're very thankful to God that we're able to not only be with you and worship with you, but that we're able to be encouraged. So we praise God for the word today, for the worship today, for the time of communion today. And we want to encourage you, if you haven't started following us on social media, please do so. If you haven't visited our website yet, then we want to encourage you to visit our website. We want you to connect with us so that we can connect with you, so that we can grow together as we learn to live and love like Jesus. So we're praying that God would bless you. We're praying that he would make his face to shine upon you. We're praying he'll lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. So Father, bless us and keep us until we're able to meet again. Thank you for everyone who has joined, first-time friends, those who are regulars, God. We pray for those who will watch, God, at a later date, that even at that time that you would speak and minister to them. Father, we look forward to great and amazing things in 2021. So have your way in our lives, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Pray that you have a great day today.
And Happy New Year.
Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Come on, even your children can say it. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Jesus is his name. Come on, one last time. Jesus, Jesus. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Proclaim it where you are. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Jesus is his name.